and everyone sitting here before me. You know, it's been a while since I've stood up here, you know, it's quite nerve-wracking. But I pray that God shall give me the courage to fulfill what I've been asked to. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
For starters, I'd like to introduce myself. You know, after I turn 18, I now go by the name of Mr. Rojo. Just letting everybody know that the name is, it's no longer Samuel, by the way. I'm Mr. Rojo. Yeah? Please stop. I'd also like to give a massive round of applause to everybody, especially the young people today who took part, you know? It's not easy standing in front of people when it's not something you normally do. So we can do better than that. I'd like to give us a round of applause for everyone who's done everything today. This afternoon, I've been told to speak about godly youth in society, you know, and what it really means to be a good Christian child. But I'd like to narrow that down a little bit and focus a bit more on who I think this message really applies to. So I'd like to talk about godly teens in society. Everybody already knows we're living in a time that's a little bit different to every single generation that came before us. And what I mean by that is we're living in an age of technology, you know? People go on and on about it enough. Apple this, mobile phone this. But what a lot of us don't understand, us young people in particular, is how different life was before the age of technology. You know, it still amazes me that while my parents were courting, before the age of technology, instead of opening their phone to go on WhatsApp, they used to get pieces of paper and write letters to each other. You know, that's something that I'll never understand. Imagine you're trying to text someone and it says 3 to 5 business days is your arrival time, you know? I find it very fascinating. A lot of teens nowadays, you know, myself included, we find ourselves in situations like this. So you go to your mom or your dad, and they're giving you a lecture about something you're experiencing or something going on in your life. And your first response to your mom or your dad is, "Mom, Dad, you don't understand. The times are different. You're old school. You know, it's not 1985 anymore. Things have changed." In some cases, that may be the case. But what I like to think is that when it comes to matters of your faith and matters of God, I believe those things never change, you know? And I believe the Bible will never be old school by the grace of God. So firstly, how many of us have a mobile device on them, right? I'm guilty, here's mine. Hands up, basically all of us, right? So what's the first thing you do when you receive your mobile device or any electrical device for that matter, right? You open the box, and you're greeted with a device and then an instruction manual, right? A little piece of paper or a little booklet. And what do? You read the manual. I know some of us here, my mom included, would rather call me to explain it to her, but generally speaking, people like to read the manual, right? You might ask why people read the manual. You know, we read the manual to fully understand how it works, you know? To be able to fully utilize the device that we bought. You know, you paid for it, you want to be able to use it to its fullest, you know? Or something a little bit more specific to people my age. Imagine you want to take an exam, right? You want to study for your exam. What do you read? You read the textbook, you read your syllabus to be able to understand what you need to do. These are both examples of when we're lacking knowledge, we have a manual to turn to be able to guide us and give us the knowledge that we need. The knowledge and the know-how to be able to perfectly execute what we need to do. Some of you might be already seeing where this is going, but as we Christians, we've been blessed with the ultimate guide to life, which we call the Bible. Thank you very much. Whenever I go to my parents to ask them something about my morality or how to act in a certain situation, they always turn to the book, you know? It used to be a little frustrating, but it makes sense. You know, even if they know the answer, they'll always back it up with scripture. It's exactly like the Bible, it's just one big manual of how we should live our lives. So the key that I like to focus on is that whatever time or age we find ourselves in, the word will always be there to guide us through life. Can we please open to John 1:1, please? So we should all know it off by heart anyway, but it says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God." So what I like to say from that is, in the future, we will still have the Word. The Word will still be with God, and the Word will remain God. So what's the relevant to teens nowadays, you may be asking? So especially in a type of environment like in this country that we live in, it's so easy to find yourselves in situations or amongst people doing stuff you really shouldn't be doing. You know, there's a term that people use nowadays that goes by FOMO, you know, which stands for fear of missing out, right? You find a lot of people nowadays, they don't want to do something, but their friends are doing it, people around them are doing it, and before you know it, you find yourselves doing it. You know, my mom loves to say, birds of the same feather, they flock together, right? So it's easy to see people around you are engaging in certain activities that you shouldn't, right? But as we Christians, we should be able to stand out from the crowd and be the light amongst the darkness. Can we please open to Matthew 5, 14 to 16, please? So it says, you are the light of the world, a town built on a hill that cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand and give light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others that they may see good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. So what do I understand by what it means to be godly youth in society? It's to be able to spot certain people or activities that you know don't really align with the word of God and being able to detach yourself from such activities. You know, it's easy to say that, but how easy is it to actually put it into practice, you know? So I'd like to talk about three main points that are important when it comes to living as a godly teen in today's society. Three points that I myself try to live by, you know? I'd be a bit of a hypocrite if I came here talking about stuff that I don't personally like to do. So number one, it's being able to have the right attitude from the get-go. You know, we should all be striving to be the perfect Christ ambassador we can be. But we all know that, importantly, it's a mental battle. It's a mental commitment that you need to give your life to Christ. It might sound boring, but we need to be the kind of individuals that... We need to be the kind of individuals that people, they're not going to waste their time asking you because they know you're not going to say yes to whatever they're trying to do. We're striving to be those type of people, to be able to remove yourself from certain situations before the opportunity even arises for any sort of sin to occur. Amen? Amen. Number two is to always try to work on your faith, you know. Most of us are students here, right? No matter what age we are. And what happens is you get to a point where you might refuse to complete any work, you don't want to do any of your assignments, and what happens is you stay the same, you plateau. It's a term we like to call stagnation, where we're no longer improving and we're just staying the same. Some people may be happy to stay the same, but as we Christians, we should be able to strive for greatness, greater and greater, in the mighty name of Jesus. But typically, what ends up happening when people stagnate is they give up on other aspects of their life and they start to backslide. We want to be constantly working on our faith. This is typically through reading the word, you know, going to church regularly, listening more on what's going on in church and seeing how you can try and applicate what's going on to your own personal life. Constant growth, that's what I like to call it. Constant growth is what we should be striving for. And finally, I like to think what is most important is to be able to be a good example to others. We all know one of the main commandments from Jesus is to spread the good news. This doesn't always have to be going out in public and giving people tracts and telling them they should become a Christian. I like to think it's more about people seeing it on your face, you know, through your actions, through the way you speak, through the way you conduct yourself. We should always try and strive to be the best we can be, you know, not only for ourselves, it's also so that people around us can try and emulate the actions that we also perceive, you know? Me personally, I'm the youngest of three in my family, and I spent a great deal of my childhood trying to emulate my older brother, trying to do things he did. I'd find myself copying things he'd say or some of his actions to try and impress my parents. And I think it's a key that as us Christians, more importantly growing Christians, is that we try and strive to be a good example that others can follow. Another example is I decided to stay at my school sixth form for college. And what you find is that teachers don't only encourage good grades, but they also encourage you to be a good role model for the younger kids in school. Being 16, 17, 18, and there's kids who are 11, 12 seeing you, it's always important to be a role model because they look up to you. You know, you find that when you start becoming older, you don't have to worry about yourself, but you also need to worry about what you do because of the children around you, what they see you do, what they see you say. Because I said earlier, kids love to emulate people older around them, you know? So I believe as Christians, it's crucial that we become the best examples that we can, not only to better our own lives, but to, as I said, to improve those around us. And to close, I want to give a little example of what a highly godly youth would be like from the Bible, you know? And, you know, it's such a coincidence that I chose my very own namesake. So can we please open to 1 Samuel 3:4, please? So it says, the Lord called Samuel, and Samuel answered, here I am. And I want to say that one more time. The Lord called Samuel, and Samuel answered, here I am. So I'm going to end with a little bonus point that I think we should try and emulate, is that we should always be available for the things of God. I remember a few weeks ago when Auntie Goodness was calling me every day, asking me to come up here and give this word, and I was very adamant. I did not want to do it. I was like, find someone else. There must be other people. But she was consistent, and so was my mum, right? I was so adamant that I didn't want to do it. But by the grace of God, I'm standing here before you. And I'm very happy to say that I'm very happy that I chose this decision, you know. And I'm happy that I didn't say no, because I would be sitting here while someone else would be here. But I'm happy that I took up that responsibility. So thank you all for listening, and especially for our youth, I hope that you can take in at least something from what I said. Thank you all for listening.